Okay, so welcome after the break. Because of COVID-19, we are not able to have an in-class lecture, so therefore I'm going to be recording this lecture and uploading all the lectures on YouTube from now onwards. So it's been 2 weeks since we talked about MDPs, so let me recall some of the important points from the previous lecture right now. So we have S, which is the state space. We have A, which is the action space, and we have T. We define T as the Bellman operator. And T was defined as follows. So T of V of S is min over A, C of S, comma A, plus expected value of V of S prime given S, comma A. Okay. And we showed in the previous class that under certain assumptions, the iteration Vk plus 1 equals to TVk converges to V star, which is the optimal value function for the MDP, so restricted, so it is under certain assumptions. Okay, and the most important thing was that V star is a measurable function from state space to R. Now you can think about the counterpart, which is the Q value iteration. So you can have Q k plus 1 equals to 2 TQK, and T would be defined in an appropriate fashion. So let me define the T for the Q value iteration. So T of Q of S comma A should be C S comma A plus, oh, I missed the discount factor alpha, so I'm going to add it up. So I added a discount factor alpha here in the definition for T, the Bellman operator for the value function, so I should do that as well here. Expected value of min over A of Q of S comma A, sorry, S prime comma A prime given S comma A. Okay, and this is the operator for the Q value iteration. Now the problem is, what's the problem? The real problem is, how do you store a measurable function? So remember, a measurable function is it's a function which is almost continuous. So it could have a few discontinuities, but otherwise it is almost continuous. So now the question is how to store almost continuous functions in a computer. Okay, and people have thought about it for a long time, and one of the best ways to store it is to have some parameterization of the function. And instead of storing the actual function, which requires infinite storage, you would store some approximation of the function. So let's say my function looks something like this. Okay, then. Sorry, my function should be continuous. So let's say my function looks something like this. Okay, so instead of storing this function, which is going to be, take a lot of space, I'm going to store these constant functions. Let me draw it with red color. So I want to store this particular function, which is a good approximation to the original continuous function. And this particular function can easily be stored within a computer. So that's the key idea for reinforcement learning, which is to somehow use function. So this somehow use function approximators to store the Q functions or the value functions, and potentially even policies within the computer in order to execute those policies or in order to run dynamic programming at a future time. So now the question is, how do you translate these equations, which is coming from contraction mapping theorem type argument, how do you apply these operators and then store these functions? Okay, so for that, I need to talk about the regression problem. So the answer to this question is use function approximators that are sort of parametrized in some way. Okay, so parametrization reduces the storage burden on the function. The fewer parameters you use, the coarser the approximation would be, but at least you will be able to store it in a computer. Okay, so let's go back to the RL problem. And the problem was, I am given S1, A1, R1, S2, A2, R2, and so on. And I've given this trajectory, and I want to compute V star using this trajectory. Now, of course, just now we said that we cannot really compute V star, or we cannot store V star in a computer. So actually we need to not compute V star, but compute an approximation to V star so that it is easy to store. Okay. All right. So, this whole algorithm can be broken into two parts. So, in the first part, the overall idea is you feed the sample ST, AT, RT sample. So, I'm using rewards now because most of the reinforcement learning recent literature in RL algorithms are in terms of reward, but the idea is the same for cost as well. So you feed the sample into some sort of regression algorithm to get an approximate V hat T or Q hat T, and then this particular V hat T and Q hat T then goes into the RL algorithm, and somehow the RL algorithm would do some sort of exploration, some exploitation, or whatever other ways of, or run a one-step Bellman operator, and then it will give you new set of samples, ST plus 1, AT plus 1, RT plus 1. Of course, sometimes you will collect a lot more samples here, and then you will do some sort of batch processing for the regression, compute V hat T and Q hat T based on the batch of data, and then the RL algorithm will then generate the next batch of state action and reward pairs, tuples. So let's talk a little bit about this regression algorithm. Okay, so what happens in a regression algorithm? So let's come up with a very simple regression algorithm. So I have a bunch of data points, okay, and the regression algorithm attempts to fit a curve that tells you from where this data point came from, okay. So typically something that you are familiar with because of optimization lectures is the linear regression problem where you try to fit, if you have a data point that is along a line, then you use a linear function to kind of explain the data. So this is your x and this is your z, which is equal to f of x. And we assume that f of x is some theta transpose x. And then you try to use, then you basically use least square problem to compute theta from data. Okay, and what is this least square problem? So let me just quickly go over it. You want to minimize, so your theta hat will be the argmin over theta in Rn. So this x is in Rn. I'm not adding a bias, but you can add a bias as well, not a big problem. And then you do 1 minus n summation zi minus theta transpose x I square. So this is x1 z1 x2 z2 xn zn. Okay, so these are the data set that you have. Okay, so you try to solve this problem. I goes from 1 to n. This is a least square problem. All of you know how to solve it using gradient descent or any other appropriate algorithm. And this gives you theta hat, and then you sort of postulate that, well, z is approximately equal to theta hat transpose x. This is the approximate relationship. Relationship between x and z. Okay, so this is a general regression problem. Now, of course, we are going to talk about what sort of functions you can assume the regression problem to have and get different sort of results, but we'll get to it in a bit. So let me try and explain to you how this is used in a reinforcement learning setting. So in order to understand that, remember the Q-learning update algorithm. So Qt plus 1 of s comma a was 1 minus beta t Qt s a plus beta t rt plus alpha max over a prime Qt of st plus 1 a prime. This is for s comma a equals to st comma at. So rt is the reward, st at is the state and action visited at time t, and then it's qt s a for all s a not equal to STAT. Okay, this is the Q learning algorithm for finite state action space. Now, what is happening here is that you want, so think of Qt as a matrix, and what you want to do is store at the SA-th position of the matrix, you want to store this particular variable. It's a real number, and you want to store this real number at that particular position. Now, when you're trying to fit a function, what you do is you define, so remember the regression algorithm that I talked about here. So you let xi be stat and you let zi be this whole thing. This big expression. And so you want your qt plus 1. At st, at, you want it to have the value of zi. Okay, so if you assume that qt plus 1 is linear function of xi, then you will try to fit, you will try to use some sort of least square approximation to get a value of theta hat. On the other hand, as we will talk about, there are a lot of different very nice function approximators that you can use to conduct this regression problem and get a very good function qt plus 1 that works very well in practice. Okay, so this is how you use the regression problem within a reinforcement learning problem. Okay, so I want to emphasize, you generate these xi zi samples, you parse it through some sort of regression algorithm, and the regression algorithm will give you some sort of function v hat t or q hat t, and then you will run the RL algorithm on top of this. Okay, so in each time step, you solve a regression problem, then you use some sort of RL type intuition. So what sort of exploration scheme you want to use, how you want to sample your action and things like that. So you use your RL algorithm to figure out what the next state action, what the action would be. You feed that action into some system or a simulator and you get the next state and the next reward, and this whole thing goes on and on. Okay, so this is what happens in if you are running an RL algorithm in a general state space setting, where this xi is the state action pair if you're running a q value iteration, or it could be just the state if you're running just a value iteration, and the zi would be the target value that you want the value function or the q function to satisfy. Okay, So in this particular lecture, we are focused primarily on this particular block. Okay, so how do you run the regression algorithm? Well, what you do is you essentially pick a class of function. So in the above example, I picked a linear class of function, but one could also pick f of x to be x transpose theta x. Okay, so this is also possible. Of course, it will give you a very bad fit, but nonetheless, you can assume that f of x is x transpose is of the form x transpose theta x, and you will get some sort of theta, and you would want to check whether your data actually fits that theta or not. So this class of functions as a function of theta are known as function approximators, and what we are going to talk about now is what kind of function approximators are useful for regression algorithms. Okay. Before we do that, we first have to go over some theory of universal function approximation. And what that theory tells you is what classes of functions can reasonably approximate continuous functions over compact states or continuous functions over bounded states. State space. Okay, so now I'm going to talk about xi as the state. So it could be either state action pair or it could just be state, and zi would be just a real number because your value functions or q functions take values in on the real line. Okay, so what is universal function approximator? So it's very useful for the regression task. So let's say your value functions or q function lie in this set of functions. Let me call it f. No, I'm going to use f later on. Let me call it L. Okay, so your value functions sit in this particular space, and you want to parameterize the function. Okay, so because you're using, so a general function is an infinite dimensional object, but you're using finite number of parameters to approximate this function. So what you're getting is some sort of grid in L. Okay, and so this is for, let's say, if you pick theta in Rn, this is the grid point you have. What would be a cool thing? to have, what would be the cool thing for the cool property that should be enjoyed by this parameterized class of functions that you have picked? Okay, so I'll write it clearly. What cool property should the parameterized class of functions satisfy? Well, the idea is you want to satisfy the following property. So for theta equals to Rn, you get that kind of grid. So it's a very coarse grid. If you let theta be in R2n, the grid should be much finer. Okay. So what does that mean? This means that as you go to a higher and higher number of parameters, you can approach any function f in the class L. So you can approach any function. So let's say you want to approximate this function v here, which sits in the space L. If you pick your theta sufficiently large, in the sense that if you pick the dimension of theta sufficiently large, you can approach the function v very closely. Okay. So in this setting, this was v, and you could only approach, you could only sit on this particular curve because you're parameterizing your function space. So the nearest point you can get is here, but in this particular situation, you can get much closer to the function v because your parameterization is much, much higher dimensional at this point of time. Okay, so overall, you have f, which is the parameterized class of function, that you have picked, and you have L, which is the class of functions of interest. Okay, and you want to have the property universal approximation property is as follows. For every g in L, there exist f in f. Oh, and for every epsilon greater than 0, for every g in L, for every epsilon greater than 0, there exists f in f such that norm of g minus f is less than epsilon. Okay, so this f, of course, depends on g and epsilon both. Okay, but at least you can find a function f within the parameterized class of functions which approximates g in a certain fashion. Okay, so the norm that I am picking here is very general. It could be an infinity norm, it could be a L2 norm, it could be some other norm on the function space. So this is known as a universal function property, universal approximation property. Okay. If you have taken a class in functional analysis, which I don't expect many of you would have taken, this is equivalent to saying that the closure of f under this particular norm is equal to L. Or f is dense in L. Okay, so ideally, if we want to optimize if you want to run a reinforcement learning algorithm, we know that my value function would sit in a much larger class of measurable function, which is collection of all continuous and discontinuous function, where the number of discontinuities is kind of few, very few. Okay, so this is the space where the value function sits, and you want to pick a parameterized class of functions such that your value function can be approximated using, very well approximated using that parameterized class. So let's understand What sort of universal approximation property is already known in the mathematical literature? So the first thing I want to talk about is Stone-Weierstrass theorem, where your L is actually the set of continuous functions over interval a comma b, closed interval a comma b. Okay, so let's pick the parameterized class f of c. F is a subset of the set of continuous functions over the closed interval a b, such that if you pick two functions from the set f, then the sum as well as the multiplication of the two functions should lie in f. Zero and constant function should lie in f. If f is in this set capital F, then minus F should also be in F, and F should separate points in A comma B, which means that if you pick any two distinct points X, Y from A, B, and X is not equal to Y, then there should be an F within this set of functions capital F, such that FX is not equal to FY. So under these conditions, what we know is the closure of F will be equal to CAB. So if you can pick an appropriate class of functions f, parameterized class of functions f, then the closure of f would be the entire space of continuous functions. So that's the universal approximation property outlined by Stone-Weierstrass theorem. And you know, I'm writing this theorem as a theorem on continuous functions over a b, but there are generalizations of this theorem available now, which works for much more general setting, so need not even be a compact set. Okay, so let's look at what are these parameterized class of functions. So the first class of functions that I'm picking is the polynomial. So these are polynomials of all degrees. Okay, so I'm taking union over all n equals 0 to infinity, and my function fx is sum of ai x raised to i goes from 0 to n. Okay, so you can, let's see if it satisfies all these four hypotheses. So if I take two polynomials, is the sum a polynomial? Yes. Is the product of two polynomials a polynomial? Yes. Zero and constant functions are polynomial? Yes. Negative of polynomial is also in this class, yes. And is f separates points in a, b? So I can pick f to be the identity function. So fx is equal to x. So therefore, if you pick x not equal to y, then fx is not equal to fy. So in some sense, this particular class of functions f satisfies all these four conditions. So it means that f approximates any continuous function in a, b. This is under the soup norm. So I didn't write the norm here, but this is the infinity norm. Okay, so under the infinity norm, f bar is, or f closure is equal to the space of continuous functions. So no matter what continuous function you pick in the interval a comma b, you can approximate it arbitrarily closely by picking a polynomial of some degree. Okay, so naturally, if you pick a polynomial of degree 1, then you have only two parameters, a0 and a1, and you will not have a very good approximation. But if you pick your degree of polynomial to be 100, then perhaps you can get a very good approximation of the function you would like to approximate. So that's a good function approximating class, and it satisfies the universal approximation property. Let's look at some other class. So this is union again n equals 0 to infinity ai exponential bi of x. Okay, so let's see if this satisfies all the conditions. So sum of exponentials, product of two exponential is an exponential, sum of two exponential would be an exponential, zero and constant would belong to the exponential function class. I can pick bi equals to 0, and I can pick ai equals to 0 or ai equals to 1 to get the zero function or constant function. The negative is fine because I can multiply ai with a negative 1, and I can show that f and minus f, both of them belongs to capital F. And then f separates points. Well, e raised to x also separates points. So if x is not equal to y, then e raised to x is not equal to e raised to y. And therefore, this particular class satisfies. This also has the property that f closure is equal to c a comma b, again under the infinity norm. Now the third class of functions is functions fx is equal to summation of ai cos bi x. Okay, again, if you multiply two, I shouldn't say polynomial, this is not a polynomial, but two sum of cosines, then you get a lot of cos a cos b terms, but we know that sum of, so cos a cos b is given by this particular identity, and so it's cos a plus b plus cos a minus b. So therefore, the multiplication of two functions of this type will lead to another function which is also of this particular type with possibly different values of ai's and bi's. Okay, so all of these satisfy the property that the closure of f bar is c a comma b. Okay, so this is very beautiful because you have a lot of function approximating classes. Now one thing I want to note here is, let's say you have a continuous function and you want to approximate using polynomial, you may have to look for a polynomial of degree 100 to approximate it very well within the interval a comma b, but you may only need 5 or 6 of these functions to approximate it, right? So the problem is you don't know a priori what sort of behavior your value function will satisfy, and therefore picking an appropriate function approximating class for the value function is very, very important. And it's not clear at this point of time if given an MDP, can you identify what is a good function approximating class for that MDP. So that perhaps remains an open problem as of now. Except for some special cases, we don't quite know what function approximating class you need to pick. So all in all, if you have you can pick whatever function approximating class you want, but perhaps your number of parameters can be different dramatically if you pick one approximating class over another. Actually, let's talk about a simple example. Let's say you want to approximate e raised to x in the interval zero, 1. Now, as you can see, if you use a polynomial, you will perhaps need a very maybe degree 10 polynomial to approximate it very well. But with a single sample, you can actually approximate this function using this function approximating class. Now, I don't quite know how many cosine functions you will need to approximate e raised to x in the interval 0 to 1. So perhaps this is something you can try using MATLAB. How many cosine functions you need, sum of cosine functions you need in order to approximate e raised to x. I don't quite know what the answer to that question is. Okay, so if you want to use polynomial, you need to have n equals to maybe 10 for polynomials, n equals to 1 for exponential. I mean, it'll give you the exact, there is no approximation, it'll give you the exact number. And then n equals to whatever, I don't quite know, for cosines. Okay, and you can come up with your own function approximating classes. And as long as you show that your function approximating class has these four properties, you can approximate any continuous function over a comma b. So that ends our discussion on Stone-Weierstrass theorem. Let's move on to Kolmogorov-Arnold's representation theorem. So this theorem is pretty, the proof is very challenging, so I'm not going to even talk about the proof, but here is the statement. So I want to approximate a function 0, 1 raised to d to r. Okay, so what does it say? If your d is greater than or equal to 2, then there are real numbers a, b, p, c, q, and a continuous and monotone function psi, which depends on d, but it doesn't depend on the function f that you are approximating, such that for any continuous function f, there exists a continuous function g. So g now is a function of f, So let me write it as function of f. So there exists a function g such that f of x1 to xd is actually summation of gf, summation of, this is xp, so pth x equals to x1 to xd, so xp is the pth coordinate of the vector x, plus qa, so q is an index here, and cq, so this a is a universal constant that depends on d, bp is a constant depends on d, cq is a constant that depends on d, gf is the only thing that depends on f. Okay, so the function can be approximate, not approximated, this is actually an equality in this particular fashion. So, you know, you can think of it as a neural network. So remember, this is a two-layer neural network where that you have an input layer, and then you have a psi layer, and then you have a GF layer, and then everything gets added. Okay, so this appears to have a two-layer neural network structure where psi is some continuous and monotone function, and GF is a function that depends on f. Okay, so it perhaps tells you that if you can, if you compose one function after another, you can potentially approximate any function f from 0, 1 to d to r. Okay, so this is another very strong function approximation theorem. The unfortunate reality or unfortunate issue with this particular result is it's an existence result. So we don't know what the function psi looks like, and we don't know how to construct this function g of f. So there exists such monotone function and this continuous function gf, but we just don't know how to construct it. So therefore, we are completely at a loss for using this theorem operationally, but it's still a good universal approximation theorem to know. And now we'll get into the parameterized classes of functions that people have talked about used in the past. But before we do that, we need to understand parametric and non-parametric function approximators. This is usually studied under the topic under the umbrella of regression. Okay, so if you want to read a book, you should look for books in statistics that talks about parametric regression or non-parametric regression. Okay, but the idea is the same as function approximation property of different types of parameterized classes. So what is the difference? So there are two different types of regression. One is parametric regression and the other is non-parametric regression. So in parametric regression, you have a theta. You have a theta, which is a parameter, and theta determines the function over the entire space. Okay, so that's a parametric regression. In the non-parametric regression, you have a theta 1, theta 2, theta n. So what you do is you divide the region into n different subregions, and your theta I is the parameter in region I. Okay, so in some sense, non-parametric regression basically, so here is the way to understand it. Parametric regression says I have a single parameter that defines the function over the entire space. Non-parametric regression says, look, the function could look very different in different regions of the space, so we should perhaps use different parameters or different so we should first identify how the different regions of the state space differ in terms of the functional properties of the data that you are seeing, and based on that you want to pick different parameters for different regions of the state space. So that's called a non-parametric regression. And you have seen the example in the previous, you've done the assignment in the previous previous assignment where you had the max of 5 values. So in assignment 3, you solved this problem. So you wanted to approximate this function. Let me write g of x. Max of x1 to x5. Okay. And you use the parametric regression where you use neural network. Okay. And then you use non-parametric, which was a k nearest neighbor, KNN estimator. Okay, so pictorially, this is the difference between parametric and non-parametric regression. So here is a set of data points, and you want to fit a function that explains this data point. So in a parametric regression, you will assume a linear hypothesis function, and you will get a linear function like this, this linear function. This is the parametric regression. Of course, you have assumed that your data is coming from a linear function, but you could as well try to fit a non-linear function, maybe an inverse quadratic or a quadratic function. It's perfectly possible, okay, and that will give you a parametric regression. On the other hand, non-parametric regression says that, look, I'm going to divide minus 1 to 1, which is where my data lies. So this is minus 1 and this is 1. So my data lies within this interval. I'm going to divide it into 4 separate intervals. Minus 1 to minus 0.5, minus 0.5 to 0, 0 to 0.5 and 0.5 to 1. So I've divided the entire region into 4 separate regions. And I've tried to fit a polynomial within these 4 regions. So I get a quadratic polynomial in this region. I get a linear polynomial in this region, then I get an inverse quadratic polynomial in the third region, and I get a linear in the fourth region. So this is non-parametric regression. Okay, so in some sense, you should have some intuition if you want to use non-parametric regressor. You should have some intuition about the state space so that you can divide the state space into regions and use different parameters in different regions. Or there are other ways of approximating a function which doesn't necessarily require you to divide the space into regions. So we'll talk about that in the subsequent classes. So with this, I'm ending this particular lecture. I'm going to talk about, so in the next lecture, we are going to talk about parametric function approximators. And then we are going to talk about non-parametric function approximators. Let me show you what we are going to do in the next few lectures. So we are going to talk about non-parametric function approximators, and then we are going to talk about randomized function approximators. Okay. So within the parametric function approximators, we'll talk about linearly parameterized function approximators, then neural network with single hidden layer, neural network with multiple hidden layer, reproducing kernel Hilbert space, radial basis functions, and then decision and regression trees. Within the non-parametric function approximator, we are going to talk about local averaging based function approximators, local modeling based non-parametric function approximators, and then global modeling and penalized modeling based non-parametric function approximators. Then we'll talk about randomized function approximators. We'll talk about random kitchen sinks. Actually, this theory is very, very simple. And then we'll have some final points of discussion, and then we will move on to the next topic. So thank you for your attention, and we'll discuss the parametric and non-parametric function approximators in the next class.